Okay, so I want to show you my new jig for sharpening my single flute countersinks. So I made this just out of some scrap steel and some UHMW. And so this is going to hold this a lot more precisely than I did before. So I have a bunch of these 49 degree scribed lines here on my tool rest. And before I get going, I want to go ahead and true my wheel up. And I'm using one of these diamond things. These are pretty cheap. I get them at Woodcraft, and you know, you don't want to breathe this stuff, but this one's in pretty good shape, you know, because when I'm using my twist drill bit sharpening jig, since I can pass back and forth here, you know, like this, when I'm sharpening, I'm not really wearing into one part of the wheel, you know, like the tool rests that have the V cut in it, they force you to cut in the same spot all the time, so you're constantly having to dress your wheel. So this one's not in horrible shape, but I'm going to just show you how I touch it up. Just don't breathe this stuff in. I always hold my breath when I do this, just so I don't breathe that aluminum oxide powder when I do this. So let me put some safety glasses on and... That's good enough. Okay, I'd like to revisit sharpening countersinks. I use countersinks like crazy in both my woodworking, metalworking, and the one I use primarily is an 82 degree countersink that is the standard American size for American flathead bolts. Now this would work with other countersinks if you wanted to. You're just gonna have to make a little bit of adjustments. The same jig will work for any angle. So if you're in Europe and you have 90 degree flathead bolts, everything is just going to be 45 degree angles. But what we have here in the United States, this is an 82 degree countersink, and this represents the included angle of the countersink right here. So there's the 82 degrees right here. Half of that is 41 degrees. Just simple geometry tells you, you know, the sum of the three angles has to equal 180, so this becomes 49 degrees. And we know by geometry that opposing angles are the same. So that's 49 there. So what I did is I made this new jig. Instead of just resting this on a piece of material like I did before and rotated it, I actually made this this jig out of steel and with some sandwich UHMW in here, and I just was kind of spitballing when I started this, so it's not the prettiest thing, but I've been using it for about a year and it's just fantastic. So it fits just this chuck, this old Cushman chuck that I have, so you can see that it's just a light fit in here, and now that just holds it with just absolutely no slop and allows it to rotate. And I've got a number 2 Morris taper drill extender that I use on my lathe. I just got it onto the tapered end of that chuck, which is also a number 2 Morris taper. So it just gives me something a little bit easier to spin. So what we'll do now is go out to the drill press, I mean out to the bench grinder, and all I have to do is lock this. Here, let me put this guy in here first so you can get a visual representation of what we're going to go do out on the bench grinder. So I just put this in here, and as long as I set this on at 49 degrees on my belt set, on my bench grinder tool rest, then, and if I get the distance right, all I have to do is rotate this. Say this is the wheel right here, and now I am grinding this exactly at the 82 degree bevel that I need, and you'll see that you'll just roll this. And you know, so what I do is you'll see the technique I do is I roll a little bit more back here and I cut a little bit more back here before I ever get to the cutting lip, and then I just finish off the cutting lip with just a very, very fine pass. And then instead of cutting phenolic material like I did before, I went ahead and cut a bunch of scrap steel, and to show you how well this works in steel, as well as, you know, anything, wood, phenolic, it doesn't matter. And these bits with this recipe, you can sharpen these things until they're gone, you know. So this thing used to be this long. You'll see the comparison a little later, But let's go out and set this up on the bench grinder and let's sharpen this guy. This countersink is pretty old. I'm not even sure how old it is. It's years old though. And I went ahead and bought a brand new one from McMaster Carr. This hasn't even been used yet. And you can kind of see the difference in how much I've ground off over the years. So this is a real money-saving technique, because if I had to buy a new one of these for $25 every time I wanted to make a really sharp cut, I'd be broke. Okay, so we're out here at my bench grinder, and you can see, you know, this is the tool rest that I made, and I'll post a link here if you want to see the video series where I made these tool rests. These things are just fantastic and were a huge upgrade over the pretty terrible factory tool rests that came with this big Dayton bench grinder. This thing's a beast, but the tool rests were a joke. But I made a much better setup, and I've got these spark diverters here too, so the sparks just get channeled back and down and into a bucket. Okay, so here's my protractor head. I have it set at 49 degrees. So I had made a bunch of marks on here, just so I do this all the time, and the different marks just allow me to deal with really long countersinks that are pretty new or ones that are very short and get the little spinning jig in the right location. So first thing we're going to do is let's just go ahead and just make a preliminary positioning setup here. So I have this, what I like to do is I like to kind of push this back in here. I don't have it tightened down yet. I like to kind of push it back in here and kind of just give it a little snug like that. And just basically figure out, okay, I just come up here and I can just kind of eyeball it and then look at my marks here and go, okay, yeah, this looks like a really good position where I'm gonna hit it pretty well. And then I just line that edge of that up to the mark that I want. And kind of hold it in place right there. And I got this little piece of wood that I can put on it. So what I try to do is, when I know I'm going to do a lot of countersinking, I just get this set up so I can just come back in here and just keep touching the bit up nonstop and not have to break this setup down. And I just keep using the same countersink over and over again. Okay, so let me pull this out. I think I've got it close enough that I can want to get it exactly on that 49 degree mark right there. Well, you'll see why I've got this other thing that I use here to hold it in place, because it does want to pivot on that slick metal, and that UHMW surely doesn't help it either. So all I have to do is just get this set up one time, and I can just, you know, keep coming back to it time and time again and not have to mess with it. Okay, that looks really good. So I also made this little plate here, and I just took a piece of scrap steel and I, you know, made sure that was ground really flat. I did it on with a file and belt sander and made sure it was really flat. Now I can just put this up here and put two clamps on it, and it's not in my way at all. And that just stops it just stops that jig from wanting to pivot in place while I'm manipulating this, because it has all that bearing surface there. And I just put a set of vice grips right here, and it's not going anywhere now. Okay, so what I do is I just put this in. Let me see if that clamp is blocking the view. Okay, so what I do now is I just bring this up and I go, okay, well that's not really touching. So all I have to do is bring this out, break that a little bit, and then just bring the countersink out of the chuck just a skosh. And now that's going to be good enough to do this and lock this down. And like I said, what I do is I roll it on the back, and I try to take off a little bit more maybe two rolls before I come up to that final edge right there. So let's do that. I think I got it just with two rolled passes, but I believe you can see that looks pretty clean. You know, that's just basically rolling it by hand, and I guarantee you this is going to cut. And now that this is set up, no matter how many countersunk holes that I want to drill, I can come back in here and just pop this back in the chuck again and just get after it. But it's pretty easy to do, really easy to do. And this gives you the ability to, like I said, shift it back or any way you want, depending on how long the countersink is that you're working with. Kind of see that, you know, I'm parallel. You can see that edge is pretty damaged, you know, so I'm gonna fix this. This has seen some hard miles. And that's all there is to it.